Okay, so today in the stem cell jungle, we meet Jon Ellis. So we have an interesting opportunity today because it's an interesting vantage point on the cell therapy industry with a serial automator in the person of Jon and from Invetech. And maybe you can introduce yourself to explain a little.
Sure, great to meet you, Maxine. So I'm Jon Ellis. I manage a cell therapy team for Invetech in San Diego. So we're a team of scientists really focused on ensuring the biology and engineering of automation go hand in hand. And I've been playing around in cell therapy now for getting on for nearly 20 years. Time flies.
Yeah. So maybe to go very straightforward into this activity that you have in the stem therapy field. So how do you automate a manufacturing process? On which items are you most sensitive when evaluating a project? And so what are the common mistakes then?
Sure. I guess to start with something that's quite obvious, requirements. If there's one thing you need to focus on, it's requirements. And not just right now. So with your best crystal ball, really need to look at what your immediate needs are and projecting forwards what you need to likely to be in 1, 2, 3, 5 years. Not that you have to know exactly what you're going to do, no one does, but you have to have some visibility of it so that as you develop your URS, you know what your expectations are in terms of your operations, input, output volumes, the basic technical requirements, but also what the business need is likely to be too. How many patients tumors is treating, how many batches do you plan to make? And so really, what are the automation drivers? Is it the number of batches? Is it the fact that you plan to operate in multiple jurisdictions? It's one thing having your process experts make some batches in your early clinical trials. When you plan to disseminate out into other manufacturing facilities using new employed, maybe people with little experience of working in a GMP environment, you really need to make sure you've got the process under control. And really, we try and balance that business and technical requirements. We can align the automation so that it's right timed. And that can really vary for some companies. It can be aligned with funding. It could be in line with an IND application. And common mistakes that we see, we're all learning, right? So I think it's some things we really see as common themes, just not being quite ready to automate. So really making sure you understand your release criteria, your product specifications, your process variability, and then align that with an automation process. It's not too late, so you have to read clinical studies, but not too early so that you're still in flux in terms of what your dose might be or how many batches you plan to make. I think in the stem cell arena, there's lots of opportunity for stem cell companies to learn from the immunotherapy findings to date. I think as an industry, we need to collaborate and really have that discussion around what does automation look like and what does that pathway to automation look like.
Okay, so in terms of mistake, you would still say it's rather a little earlier than a little later, or it's finding the sweet spot is a...
The sweet spot varies for different applications, yeah. I think. And but when we say automation, it's not push a button, walk away. That's the vision, to be honest, still the future, but still way away from that. And so it's really what's right size for now and how can it grow with you over time.
Yeah. So a very, I think, interesting question is how much money and time is needed to automate a process? Again, ballpark, I guess.
It's not going to surprise you to hear me say it depends.
Yeah.
Right. Obviously. And the real it depends comes from how much development you need to do. So if you do existing technologies that you've used that are proven, and maybe it's an integration exercise, that's a bit more straightforward than having to develop new technologies, which has an unknown timeline, really. But there are pros and cons against different approaches. So off-the-shelf technologies They can be arranged in series as part of the production process. We know what they do. Those platforms have been around for a number of years. But it may be limited in terms of scalability, having to use lots of different single-use sets from different platforms to integrate together. But then, the more fully automated role or fully automated system may take longer to develop, be more costly, but ultimately you can design that around your process. And so you can look at the cogs and the process efficiency and drive down costs later on. So I guess the ideal model is a hybrid model where you've got technologies you use now, maybe in a off-the-shelf individual unit operation level, but then ideally be able to use those same tools in a fully automated system further down the line. So I guess without answering the question of how much and how long, it just depends on the complexity. And I think one of the things that needs to be considered as well are the ancillary processes that people maybe don't consider as much. So pretty boring stuff in some ways, such as media prep, viral vector prep. It's fine to blend media under a hood for 1, 2, 3, 4 patients if you start treating in the autologous space, making doses for hundreds, thousands, tens of thousands of patients per year. Ultimately, that's a much greater challenge. And so automation around some of the ancillary processes can really help drive down your operator costs as well. And I guess finally, the thing that impacts cost is scalability. So in the allogeneic space, for example, how big is a batch? Right. So maybe upstream, you can make a dose for 1,000 patients, but can all the rest of your process steps align with that? So for example, maybe after your culture phase, you've got enough cells for 1,000 doses, but can you actually formulate and freeze 1,000 doses at the same time? So it's a pretty complex scenario for some people, but I think the key to keeping cost and timeline to a minimum, again, is really just making sure you really understand your requirements.
Okay, and so you would say like entry point requirements, the most easy case study you could do for an automation. Could you give a ballpark of time that you would get for an easy entry point thing?
Sure. So a relatively straightforward automation step may take somewhere in the order of 12 months if it's really a case of limited development, aligning off-the-shelf technologies, maybe not a huge integration into manufacturing execution system. Ballpark, somewhere like 12 months is feasible for something relatively straightforward. But beyond that, it really can vary quite significantly depending on the scope.
And could you speak ballpark costs for the same thing?
I think there are too many variables to give a baseline cost. It's certainly, in any project, one of the first things we do with our clients is to develop the business case and review the projected timelines and costs. So we're very sensitive to investment for our clients. We need to make sure that as they embark on this journey, they have very clear expectations around what it's going to take. And so it's something that's very project specific and something to spend a fair amount of time on at the beginning of a project. But I don't think there's here's what it would cost approximately. It really depends on the individual use case.
Okay. And so then the key factors, so you touched on that, but the key factors that are driving this time and money expenditure. So maybe as a, because you said quite a few things, but to put it in a nutshell.
Sure. Requirements, understanding requirements. Is there any technology development required? And the scope, what kind of scale, operating multiple jurisdictions, those kind of things can impact timeline and cost quite significantly.
Yeah. So what's your business model? Is it different for biotechs on one hand and pharmas on the other hand, or is it very homogeneous?
I think our core approach is the same. So we're heavily focused on helping our clients get to GMP manufacturing. So the core approach to what we do is the same, but of course there are differences. Biotechs, particularly smaller, early startup biotechs, don't focus on their approach often. Their automation development is heavily impacted by their investment and the milestones required for that investment. And so that can impact the automation and probably much more focus on good enough right now. Understandably, they want to get quickly into clinic and start treating patients and seeing how feasible their therapeutic is. On the other side with pharma, that tends to be using a therapy that's already kind of proven in terms of safety and efficacy. And they're much more focused on things like integration into management execution systems, the quality and regulatory approach, and scalability in COG. So the focus of our clients is different, but our core approach is the same.
So it's, I mean, to accommodate for the different financial capacities of the two type of entities, you still have the same business model, or is it adapted to their capacities to some extent?
So the business model is kind of the same, but the expectations of a project are a little different.
Yeah.
So in terms of the scope, the degree of automation that might be being considered, that tends to diverge between pharmas and biotechs. But our approach to it is the same, is we're still focused on the right level of automation for our clients at the right time. But it's just the scope of the project is often quite a bit different. But it varies. I mean, some biotechs are very heavily focused on the vision of their manufacturing future and really want to invest in it now and really have it locked down. Others sometimes less so.
Yeah, there's a huge diversity, I think, in that case.
It's exciting.
Yeah. So, again, touching to that, since the cell therapy field has been attracting quite some significant investment of late, did you notice change in the type of requests that you get from biotechs or pharmas?
Yeah, quite a bit, actually. So I think our clients now are much more educated in automation and what the requirements of a commercial process are. I think a few years ago, to be a vision that we would have that, you know, box where a bag of cells goes in, bag of cells comes out, and the operator will press go, and that will be it. And that's just not realistic right now because the biology is not there yet in understanding exactly what's required of a therapeutic, and really also the engineering that would align with it. So I think we've now seen more pragmatism around perhaps integrating modular technologies. I think the dual in one solution will get there, but not there yet. And so I think that's been a bit of an evolution in the field. It's just a greater understanding. I think as well, we've seen it's such a change in types of requests. So I've been doing this now since 2003 at Invetech. And so in the early days, a lot of feasibility studies, wanting to go from nothing to everything, probably. And now, again, we see a lot more of a stepwise approach. So that's been quite an evolution.
So that's the way you, because I was about to ask, how did you adapt to that? But that's really this morph into like a continuous approach to a chunked approach to, yeah, to dealing with, yeah. That's the yeah, way you work with that.
Yeah, it's a stepwise. So again, it's, yeah, the right automation at the right time.
Yeah. Okay. So in that time span, because you spoke about 2003, which actually the time I started to work with pluripotent stem cells, so it's funny. So what technology or expertise did you incorporate to meet the demand in that time span? If you have
That's been quite an evolution. And so I think one of the things that we've grown significantly in the last few years has been our application science capabilities. So we're not a CDMO. Our role here is, from a science perspective, to make sure that as we develop automation, that we're not impacting the biology,
yeah,
of the therapeutic. And so we've really grown those capabilities, and we strongly believe that having an integrated biology and engineering team really de-risks a lot of the automation development. I think that's been quite a big change that's happened at Invetech in the last few years, as we've now started to really see a growth in the need for automation in space.
And thinking of like the recent development of rapid prototyping, it's something that you've also included in your workflows, or it's...
Yeah, that's always been the approach, really. So, it's a big part of what we do. So, we want to de-risk as quickly as possible in any project. And so the key thing is identifying where the technical challenges are, where the hurdles are. And like you said, to develop prototyping, again, aligning biology and engineering to ensure that we can overcome those technical hurdles early on before we get too deep into the automation development. And that's just a core part of what we do.
So even though there is a rise in funding, cell therapy manufacturing is still at a very early stage, I would say. And what are the key areas that will need improvement, according to you, to raise quality, scale up, and help reduce the costs of these therapeutics?
I think all those things are actually quite well aligned. Right now, COGS are heavily impacted by FTU requirements. People in the process are expensive. People in the process can also impact quality and scale as well. And so really, again, introducing appropriate automation to reduce the FTU requirements, and it's a problem for the field. There aren't that many people who are trained to operate in GMP environments. And as the industry is starting to explode, there's a real gap there in terms of having enough trained people. And so I think to raise quality, it's really improved manufacturing data capture, and by data capture it can be the specifics of a technology, but also ideally more automated and inline analytics. So right now, having to take a sample, go to a separate lab, to a different team to get a cell count, to figure out what you need to do with your cells, it's a very manual and risk-driven process. And so have the ability to have inline analytics, which can then feed into your manufacturing process and make real-time manufacturing decisions, would definitely greatly improve quality, reduce risk. And it's quite exciting to see that some of those technologies are now starting to come online. So I'm hoping that'll be a big area for development in the field. Also, I think really wanting to see a growth in some of the technologies out there that can be scaled from process development through to commercial. And that's both in a scale up and scale out model as well, so that there isn't a need to do a process for a period of time and then completely change your process or change parts of your process to operate at a larger scale. Again, that impacts cost and development times. Having that ability to scale is really quite important. And again, to reduce costs, one of the things that I think would be great to get to is release by exception. So the burden to review batch records is enormous, and I think that in some cases, the people within batch records almost number the number of people making the therapies in terms of FTE. And again, that's a burden that really isn't sustainable. So with more automation, more data capture, more process control, hopefully moving to that release by exception level would be really significant for improving quality and reducing costs.
Yeah. So you envision in-process control to help not only with like stopping a batch that would go wrong before you do all the testing and you actually spend all the medium, but also to help with release, with less delay in releasing the batches?
Yeah, less delay and less burden. And also, the key again is understanding your manufacturing process. It's two things you're maximizing. One is if a batch simply isn't going to proceed, being able to make that decision earlier, but also understanding some of the finer details around the batch production. So if you add a certain amount, say, of cytokine at a certain point, how does that impact the cell growth? And to be able to get inline analytics and then know, okay, no one is not X amount of cytokine or Y amount of media or do media exchange, because this is what happens in batches at this point, that's really quite a powerful tool. And give you a greater chance of batch success.
So do you think, because again, you've been integrating quite some time about how to automate processes, do you think the single-use trend is going to hold, or is it a transitory thing? How do you see it develop?
It's a good question. I think we know in the industry we generate a lot of plastic, and it's not good environmentally, it's not good from a cost perspective. And so in some ways it's hard to get away from single use materials, things that contact the cells or critical excipients. You know, there's de-transmission risk, the leachables, extractables, profiles. We need to maintain those because we need to make sure that we're not introducing risk into the therapeutic. But I think there's definitely an opportunity to put more thought into the development of some of the single-use elements in the process to really minimize the amount of single-use material and try and restrict it just to the fluid path of the cells and any critical reagents, and possibly, you know, maybe things like design more supports, more platforms that this single-use sets can clip into on machines to be able to reduce the amount of waste we're generating. I think it's a great point and something that has been building more to improve.
Yeah. So you could maybe make a drawback versus advantage of the key technologies that are available to manufacture, because there's quite some of them. So from your standpoint?
I'd argue there aren't enough technologies available.
Yeah.
Manufacturing therapies. Some have been around for quite a long period of time, and the advantage of those is they're proven. We know what they do. From a regulatory perspective, it's low risk. But the drawbacks are that some of those technologies weren't really developed for the purpose they're being used for now, and maybe aren't optimal. And that also means they don't always scale particularly easily. And so I think for those technologies, the things that could improve them further are the ability to improve connectivity, data management, and so on. But I think for paradigm shift in manufacturing efficiency, we need new tools, new technologies. There are some interesting things obviously coming out there. Tree Frog obviously got something very exciting in development. And there are other companies out there as well, some interesting acoustic washing technologies, some new transfection technologies out there, which are looking quite exciting. But I think to get those technologies to where they need to be, it's going to have to be a collaborative approach. In the industry, we're going to have to work together. Yes. And get excited by technologies and not wait for somebody else to try it first, because someone's going to be first. And I think working collaboratively to understand more about technologies, how they can be implemented safely, and having working groups to really look at the new tools available, and make sure they can be connected from fluidic perspectives and from data again. I think it'd be a great way to, across the industry, enable the integration of them, and give us more choices.
Yeah, it's interesting, this question of integrating. I wanted to jump on. So do you think you need there is a need to homogenize data collection, or that there is a need of a better homogeneity in order to plug these different technological blocks? Or?
Yeah, 100%.
Yeah.
Having data standards in the industry that we all stick to, I think, will be really powerful and make the plug-and-play nature of tools far easier. And we see it a lot, so there are different MES and DCS tools out there to enable manufacturing, and having to reinvent the wheel every time in terms of how the data can be used and controlled, it's burdensome and doesn't really add a lot of value. It's just something you have to do, but it'd be far better if you didn't. If there were just data standards, it would mean that the plug and play nature would be far more efficient.
Yeah. Are there technologies that you decided that you would not use at Invetech?
So we work closely with our clients to choose the right technologies. I think where it gets challenging isn't always a technology. It can sometimes be challenging from maybe a business perspective. So again, being collaborative, so as our clients may want to use certain technologies, those technology providers wanting to work with the client to solve problems and be supportive is critical. And so we frequently integrate third-party technologies into our automation systems, and really ensuring that you have that collaborative approach is crucial. If that's not there, then it becomes a real challenge to be able to do that efficiently. And also moving forward as well for the supply chain. When you're developing an automation solution, you want it for the long term. You need security in supply chain. And so, again, having that real close collaborative relationship is key.
And so, yeah, so it's more less of a directly technological thing rather than the capacity of the technology provider to work in a collaborative way. That would be your...
Yeah, I think so. There aren't technologies that we would say we're not going to use them from a technology perspective if they're the right tool. Again, we're working with our clients to select the right technology for their process. And that's the really key part of it, is that whole collaboration.
But then have you seen redundant mistakes coming with a technology that requires more improvement? And if people would already make the leap from this approach before coming to automation, it would be a benefit, or nothing of the such?
Yeah, so there are some new technologies which are exciting, but probably do need a bit more development before they're ready for integration into a fully automated platform. And there are some technologies that maybe we've seen that we don't think perform as well as they could. So we're working with our clients to select the right tools. And if, in our experience, a particular tool isn't going to be the right tool for them, then we have that conversation up front and collaborate to pick the right ones. So we obviously have a perspective on how suitable some of the tools are in the industry, and really just making sure we understand requirements and pick the right ones.
Yeah. And bouncing back on what you just said, so are technologies that are promising but needs improvement, according to your experience?
Yeah, so I think with some of the new technologies, you see a real potential, and we see that within certain conditions, they work really, really well. But as of yet, maybe they're not fully optimized to be able to work well in the range of conditions they're likely to see in a true GMP manufacturing facility. So for example, incoming materials in terms of cells can be highly variable. And so with new technologies, it's making sure they can handle that incoming variability and still perform at the same level. And that, with new tools, that's where we often see the gap. And so we're very keen to work with those companies to help solve that and bridge that gap and make sure that the tools can be robust across a range of conditions, but that tends to be where the gap is. And that's not surprising, because it takes time to build up that exposure, that experience, and be able to optimize.
And you said something very early in the discussion that automatizing a workflow is something, but making sure that input and output are up to scale is a quite important step to make sure of to begin with. Do you have some additional comments on that?
Yeah, no, I think that's true in the auto and allo space. You'd probably say more so in the allo space. So being able to make batches at the scale you want, and can the tools you have get you there? What idea in allo you want to do is scale up. So have a tool or technology that can just be simply scaled would be the right approach, or this most streamlined approach. A scale out manufacturing process in an allo setting probably isn't as efficient as you'd like it to be. We probably have to have a scale up model. So that can be something that really needs a focus to understand. Again, where do you plan to be, and can you get there with the tools that you have?
And in terms of, let's say downstream in very wide sense, has Invetech worked on on simplifying the work on the endpoint side, on the surgical, on the surgeon side, on the hospital side? Is there technologies that are promising on that?
So you mean for the administration of therapy?
Yes.
We haven't really done a huge amount on that to date. So almost without exception, after our therapy provider clients, the end of their process is free cells in bags or vials or both. And partly because they're operating in a centralized manufacturing model. So that is the end of what a centralized manufacturing facility does. The cells are frozen, and then shipping them off to administering is something that happens quite separately. That's not to say, of course, that won't be something that we end up working on in the future with somebody, but as of yet, really, the end point does just tend to be formulating filling in bags and vials.
Yeah, because most products are infusions, like IV infusion products.
Yeah, correct. Most administration methods are simply cells going in through an IV or a port from a bag or a vial. We have done some tissue work with some clients. Again, it's been more around the manufacturing of those tissue therapies and less around the actual administration to the patient. But it's interesting, and something that we may see grow in future as we work with more people and again start thinking about streamlining and being able to simplify manufacturing in terms of what you have to do at the hospital side. And packaging, I imagine packaging is also quite a challenge with some of the tissue therapies where you really want obviously sterile packaging with good integrity. But packaged in such a way that it's easy in the administration setting to be able to remove the therapy and administer it. So, yeah, I think that'd be an interesting thing to see how it goes in the coming years.
Yeah, very interesting. What would be your best memory as a scientist?
My best memory as a scientist was actually one Christmas day a few years ago, just developing a new manufacturing technology, and the reason why I enjoyed it, it was a real breakthrough. Happened on Christmas Day, no distractions, no meetings, no calls, just focusing on the science and enjoying it. I guess that probably says a lot about me and how much I prefer cells rather than people. I'm not sure, but certainly that was the highlight of my my scientific career.
I can relate to that. Yeah. Do you have a resource that you would like to share to the audience?
Yeah, so I think again I mentioned the application science where we've done at Invetech. I think we've really seen the benefit of that and really how powerful it can be to have integrated engineering and science teams so that we can develop automation systems which are de-risked from both an engineering and a science perspective. I feel that's really a resource that we've developed and very strongly, and it really helps with just streamlining that development phase. I think it's less efficient to build something, ship it to a client without having done the science testing, if you like, and then send it back and we do development. Far better to iterate on site collaboratively, and then when it goes to our client, it's already been at least proof of principle tested and should allow for a more streamlined process. So I think that's our biggest development resource that we've got.
So just thinking about with the boom of biotechs and cell therapy initiatives recently, do you think there is value in procuring resources to help educate all those projects so that they have less of a clunky transition to automation? Or is something that you are thinking about within Invetech or not?
Sorry, Martin, could you repeat the question?
Yeah. Since there is quite a lot of projects arriving to in a more mature phase, because it's kind of the sigmoid curve. I mean, we are still, there's probably quite a lot of biotech Swiss projects that are coming in the next years. Do you think there is a resource on how not to make mistakes to arrive to automation so that it would run more smoothly from, let's say, academic or biotech project into collaborations with automation specialists?
Yeah, absolutely. I think one thing we're very focused on at Invetech is lessons learned. So after every project we do, we debrief in extreme detail and we look at what went well and what didn't go well. Because we're all in Invetech just as much as our clients are. Despite the experience we have and the tools we have, there's always opportunity to do better. And so I think it would be interesting across the industry maybe to have the ability to share some of our learnings and our experiences to try and help avoid some of the pitfalls that we see with automation. I think that'd be quite an interesting thing to do. But in terms of project to project, again, not saying the same thing over and over again, really just understanding your process and your requirement is a really good start. If you've got that right, then it makes the rest of it so much easier. An automation project where the requirements would change partway through would be certainly a big challenge.
Yeah. So, So if you buy a house, it's location, location, location. If you automate, it's requirements, requirements, requirements.
That's exactly right.
Okay.
Exactly right. Yeah.
Okay. So thanks a lot for this interview, for sharing your expertise and all of these points. And I think there is quite a lot of work for Invetech in the years to come, due to the dynamic of the cell therapy field.
Thank you, Maxime, and the same for Tree Frog. I think it's going to be a very exciting time coming up, and very keen to see where your technology goes. And hopefully, we'll see a lot of people out there using your tools and having the opportunities to improve the yield of their manufacturing process.